What's up, everyone? My name is Roshni, and welcome back to my channel. This channel is called Beti Group, and it's all about how to take back control of your mental health. This is actually the first installment of the series called Lessons I've Learned, and I wanted to create this series just so every month I could kind of make a summary of what I've learned that month and what I've experienced, and my birthday was the perfect time to start one, and then I'll start again next month in August. Let's just jump into it. The first thing that I've learned this month is that you have to make space for yourself, and you have to hustle. So when I was turning 23, I hadn't even thought of my business idea yet. I hadn't started this YouTube channel. All of this has happened within the last year. So there's been, you know, a lot of growing points, everything from starting a website, creating a brand, starting a YouTube channel, starting an Instagram for a business, a Twitter, like all these different things happen. I think what the biggest thing that I've learned throughout this journey of starting a business and starting a YouTube channel is that you have to make space for yourself, and that no one else is going to do it for you. And I think it's a little bit more difficult when you don't look like, you know, the majority culture and majority of who's shown in the media, rich, tall, white people that are really, really attractive. Like, if you don't, you know, fit all of those stereotypes, there's another barrier to getting there as well. You know, no one's going to pull out a seat at the table and just invite you to come in and present your ideas, especially when you don't fall into those categories. But even if you do, you know, there's a lot that you have to do to prove yourself, to say that you're there, and no one's going to ask you to start doing that. You have to do that yourself. So that's one of the most valuable things that I've learned this year. And I learned that as much as people say, you know, you should follow your heart and you should, you know, if something's making you anxious, you should stop doing it. But at the same time, I've learned how to push myself and how to push the boundaries of my comfort zone. And a lot of the times that I've been really anxious, or that, you know, I've had difficulties like adjusting to things, have been the times where I've also been much more likely to grow and to be a better person and to learn more. So I'm kind of trying to like learn this healthy boundary of making sure that, you know, I'm not so uncomfortable all the time that I kind of freeze up and, you know, stop being productive, but that I'm also challenging myself and pushing myself to be who I know I can be, and I don't stop myself short before, you know, I even really get started doing all the things that I know I can do. The second lesson that I've learned is that I now aspire to having a strong intuition as much as I do having, you know, a great amount of intellect. And for the last, you know, maybe even 10 years of my life, like, I didn't prescribe to any religion. I was definitely an atheist. I thought, you know, most like spiritual things or spiritual happenings could be explained in some sort of like neurological way. While I do think that that is definitely true when there's, you know, so much that you can find in science, I've also learned a lot in the last few years that research can be, you know, manipulated. Lots of companies pay to have research come out in certain ways. There's lots of flaws in science, lots of studies that still come out inconclusive. There's so many things that science hasn't approached studying yet, or that, you know, with the way that research works, like psychology and things like that work, is that there's so much variation with every single thing, that if you were to study one thing in one country, you would pretty much have to study it in multiple other countries to see if culture has an effect. There's just such a big variation, but from person to person, country to country, language to language. I think over the last few years, learning that and learning that, you know, just because something is science-based or there has been research done on it, doesn't mean that it's like infallible, or doesn't mean that research can't be proven wrong, or, you know, even just adjusted or slightly tweaked as we learn and find out more things. But overall, I would say that the lesson is still that, you know, I need to value my intuition and my own, like, personal math as much as I do intellect. Realizing that, you know, science isn't perfect and that experts in any given industry aren't always perfect either has made me value my own intuition and my own kind of gauge about things. And also, you know, when I do listen to my intuition or I practice things, a lot of the times, you know, I end up not regretting it, or I'm really thankful and really grateful that, you know, I had the presence of mind to listen to myself. Building off of that, my third one is that I've actually really developed a spiritual practice. So, like I said, I don't necessarily prescribe to any particular religion right now, but I have been, you know, getting more in touch with meditation, the universe, and what I love about the universe. And I've really kind of been tapping into like this energy, this source energy, and part of that, you know, has been through like the books that I've been exposed to. But even before, I'd always kind of said like, I am sort of a spiritual person, but at the same time, I don't believe in anything, so I don't really know what to do with that. And in some way, I did feel like, you know, we are all connected, and you know, there's literal physical aspects of nature in us. Everything on earth is made out of, you know, like the same basic materials when you really get down to like compound structures and things like that. So realizing, you know, kind of the oneness in everything and how powerful that was something that I already had experienced and already had known about, you know, a few years ago. But recently I have been learning about, you know, how I can tap into my own spiritual practice without necessarily following a certain organized religion or going to church every Sunday, but just kind of my own practice with meditation, with listening, with finding signs from the universe, with, you know, talking back and forth to the universe. Like, all of these things have been so real to me and have helped me make some major decisions. And that kind of leads me to like the whole idea that time is kind of just a construct as well, and that, you know, you really can visit different aspects of your own current life and other lives through meditation and through these discussions and through your connection to the universe, and realizing that time is not even as strict, I guess, as we think it is fascinating. But just having this constant back and forth, give and take relationship with the universe also helps me connect to my own intuition. Just like I'm a little bit more connected to other humans, it allows me to be a little bit more forgiving, and it allows me to be more compassionate. And I find all of that to be obviously extremely important and extremely helpful in daily life. Another one that I wanted to talk about is respecting my own differences. So for a long time, you know, I talked about this earlier in their video, but just, you know, not falling into like the stereotypical idea of what is attractive or what is valued. And, you know, growing up, I wasn't always shy, and there were times that I was really funny and really extroverted, but I spent a lot of my childhood, especially after moving to America, being really shy and being kind of uncertain and not sure about social situations. And I don't think that that was just me. I think a lot of that had to do with moving and being in a new country. It doesn't matter how I look. It doesn't matter that I'm introverted. It doesn't, like, I'm actually really glad that I'm an empath. And instead of seeing all these differences as things to be, like, afraid of, or as things to not like, or as things to, you know, judge, I've instead been able to completely embrace that. And that has been such a powerful feeling, because I've honestly been able to just see those as my strengths and cultivate them and really lean into them instead of hiding from them or running away from them. And yeah, I mean, that's just been a major, major lesson for me. It's done wonders for my self-confidence, but it's also done wonders for my sense of belonging and my sense of purpose. That's been a huge one, is just honoring and leaning into my differences as much as possible, because no matter what, you're not gonna be able to change into something that you're just not. Like, you can learn to be different, you can learn to think about things differently, but if there's something about you that was just how you're born, you know, there's a lot of things about yourself that you can't change. And when you're constantly forcing yourself to change those things about yourself, it just makes you feel even worse about who you are, because you feel like you have to cover yourself up or hide yourself or be a different person or put on a mask when you go out in public or when you're in society. And that's frustrating, because on a deep, deep level, that really eats at you, because you're saying like, I'm so not good enough that I have to completely change myself to even go to the grocery store. And like, that's obviously really damaging. So I wanted to touch on that, because that was a huge lesson. And I think for so long I spent so much time being so self-conscious about every little thing, from how I looked to my personality. And now it's just about embracing it and saying, you know what, this is who I am and I love it and I can have fun like this, and there's nothing stopping me from, you know, just enjoying life in this body. And that is like the most liberating feeling you could possibly have.